Well, good morning, everyone. We want to welcome you here to Pine Level Missionary Baptist Church. Thank you so much for joining us, and it's such a wonderful thing to be able to see smiley faces. Amen. It's one thing to see smiley faces and another thing to just look at a camera. So thank you for being here for our worship time this morning. Let me mention just a couple things as far as prayer requests are concerned, and then we'll open up with a word of prayer. We'll begin our time of worship this morning. If you'll continue to pray for Mr. Graham Pickett. He had surgery this past Friday, hip replacement surgery, and you'll continue to lift him up in your prayers. Also, Kim Peden has surgery that's scheduled for Thursday the 30th, so if you'll continue to remember her, I know she would appreciate that. And then if we can also remember Andy Styron's family and his passing, continue to pray for that family as well. But as we begin our time together this morning, I want to welcome you as well as those that are watching us online. Again, thank you for watching. We're streaming our service this morning on Facebook Live. So we are grateful for those who are able to watch us online as well. But let's open up this morning with a word of prayer. Father, we love you today. And God, we thank you so much for the gift of life. Lord, we thank you for a beautiful day that you've given us where we're able to come out and gather here on our campus to be able to lift up and exalt the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for what you are doing in the hearts and the lives of people. Even in the midst of this pandemic that we find ourselves in, Lord, we're so thankful that even through this time, that the church has continued to be able to meet. We thank you for the means of social media and modern technology. But Lord, what a wonderful thing it is to be able to gather here once again on our campus, to be able to see our folks, to be able to encourage one another, to be able to smile and to lift one another up. And Father, I pray today through this service, in all that's said and done, I pray that Jesus Christ would be lifted up and exalted. Lord, I pray by chance if there's someone that's either here or watching online that does not yet know Jesus in a real and personal way, I pray that today would be the day of salvation for that soul. God, I pray you would lead, guide, and direct us today. May Jesus be glorified, for it's in his name I pray. Amen. Heather's going to come for and sing a song for you at this time. Close from above. Well, amen. Thank you to my wonderful bride for that lovely song. If you will, go ahead and grab your Bibles and turn to the Gospel of Mark. Mark chapter 3 is where we're going to be this morning. Mark chapter 3. This morning we'll be looking at verses 1 through 12 as we continue our series through the Gospel of Mark, the series simply entitled Servant and Savior. You know, it's been a joy to work through this book, and a number of years ago I had the opportunity to travel to Israel, and one of the things I wanted to do since that time is to be able to preach through the Gospel of Mark, because Mark is such a fast-paced gospel. There's so many events that take place, but what a relevant word for us today. So I'm thankful for God, for His divine sovereignty, and the fact that that He knows better than we do. Amen. You know, we're down here wringing our hands trying to figure out how in the world we're going to make it and what are we going to do, and God's got all this under control. Amen. He's still on the throne, and we praise God and thank Him for that. Take your Bibles and turn to Mark chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. I'm going to ask if you'll stand in reverence of God and the reading of His holy, inspired, and inerrant word. I'm going to read through verse 12. I'm actually going to preach verses 1 through 6, but let's read through verse 12. Beginning in verse 1, the Bible says, "He entered again into the synagogue, and a man was there whose hand was withered. They were watching him to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath, so that they might accuse him. He said to the man with the withered hand, 'Get up and come forth.' And he said to them, 'Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath, to save a life or to kill?' But they kept silent. After looking around at them with anger, grieved at their hardness of heart, he said to the man, 'Stretch out your hand.' And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored. The Pharisees went out and immediately began conspiring with the Herodians against him as to how they might destroy him. Jesus withdrew to the sea with his disciples, and a great multitude from Galilee followed, and also from Judea, and from Jerusalem, and from Idumea, and from beyond the Jordan, from the vicinity of Tyre and Sidon, and a great number of people heard all that he was doing and came to him. And he told his disciples that a boat should stand ready for him because of the crowd, so that they would not crowd him. For he had healed many, with the result that all those who had afflictions pressed around him in order to touch him. Whenever the unclean spirits saw him, they would fall down before him and shout, 'You are the Son of God.' And he earnestly warned them not to tell who he was." Thank you. You may be seated. Before we begin the message, let's ask the Lord's blessing upon it. Father, again, we thank you for your precious word. And God, I pray this morning that you would speak through me, your servant, that you would hide me behind the old rugged cross. And more than people would see me, I pray they would see Jesus Christ lifted up and exalted. Lord, I pray that you would speak to us, that you would challenge us, that you would encourage us, that lives would be changed, and that souls would be saved. For we pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. This morning, as we continue the series, I want to just go back to last Sunday and just a little recap as to what we were talking about last Sunday. The focus was on the Sabbath, on Saturday. We typically tend to think of the Sabbath as Sunday, but back during Old Testament times, the Sabbath was Saturday. And under the Old Covenant, the Sabbath was to be a day of rest. And as I mentioned last week, you know, I want to praise God and thank Him today that we're not living under the law, but we're living under the new covenant. We're not under law, but praise God, we're under grace this morning. And the Sabbath was important then, and it's important for us to observe a Sabbath today. As I mentioned last Sunday, Sabbath means to rest. And everyone needs a day of rest. Amen? We all need a day of rest. And it's important that we rest, because when we rest, what you and I are doing is we are following the commands of God. And that's a good thing. But the problem here in the text before us, and the text we looked at last Sunday, was not just concerning the Sabbath and breaking the laws of the Sabbath, but it was breaking man's law. You see, the Pharisees, what they had done is they had taken the law of God, the Ten Commandments, and they created a bunch of laws around those laws. So what they were saying is, not only do you need to follow God's law, you need to follow all of the laws that we have created that surround the laws of God. And in the account before us, Jesus is more than aware of the day as to which he's performing this miracle. Jesus knows that it's the Sabbath. He knows what day it is. I mean, he created the day, amen? And he knew what the day held. And he was aware of their laws as well. But most importantly, the thing I think we need to think about here is the fact that Jesus knew their heart. He knew man intimately. He knows you better than you know yourself. So for the next few moments, as we look at this text, I simply want to share a message that I've entitled Good and Evil. If you're taking notes, I want to point out four truths to you. And the first is this. I want you to notice the spectators. Now the scene shifts here from the grain fields. Remember last Sunday they were in the grain fields. They were plucking the heads of grain. And it shifts from the grain fields into the synagogue. Now, earlier in the book of Mark, Jesus taught in the Capernaum synagogue. Now, here the text does not specifically say which one it was, but the Bible says that he entered into a synagogue. And here's the thing I want you to keep in mind. Jesus brought a new message. His message was not like the message of old, not like the message of these Pharisees and of these scribes and of these false prophets. Yes, his message contain the Word of God. He is the very Word of God. And his teaching drastically differed from that of the Pharisees. You see, when they heard Jesus, they were amazed at what they were hearing. I want you to think about that. If you would have been where they were and you could hear the Word of God, well, guess what? You can hear the Word of God today, amen? Because the Word of God is God's holy Word. So Jesus was God in the flesh. He was speaking the very word of God. And why is it that we're living in a day when people don't want to hear the word of God? I mean, people will open their ears to any and everything, but when you start speaking about God, start talking about Jesus, start proclaiming truth, it's as though they want to shut their ears. They don't want to hear, thus saith the word of the Lord. But let me remind you this morning, the Bible, this word is living, it's powerful, it's sharper than any two-edged sword, it's able to pierce and penetrate to the depths of the soul, to the joint and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. This very word right here has the power to change lives, amen? And you're living proof of that this morning, that Jesus has come into your life, that the word of God, the living word, has changed your life, and has saved your soul, and I'm grateful for that today. So Jesus enters this synagogue, and Mark says that they were watching him. Imagine what that must have been like. Jesus comes into the synagogue. They've got their eyes lifted up. They've got their shoulders squared back, and I bet they're murmuring and talking to one another, saying, oh, here he comes. Here he comes. What's he going to say? What's he going to do? I mean, they were standing there looking all religious. I mean, they were dressed in their fine apparel. They had the best seats in the house. And they were possibly even throwing the flag at Jesus. The yellow flag. You know what I'm talking about. These Pharisees were nothing more than spectators. You see, a spectator is an onlooker, an observer. It reminds me of sporting events. Now, I know some of you are sports fans. And some of you are excited that Major League Baseball just started back. I mean, they're working on football training right now. But I want you to think about it in regards to this. For those who are diehard football fans, I want you to think about times in the past when you've been able to attend a game. I mean, it's game day, right? It's game day, and you are pumped up. You know what I'm talking about. I mean, you go and you grab out of your closet your fine apparel, your team's apparel. You put that on. You paint your face. You dye your hair. You get your flags for your favorite team, and you hang them in your windows, and you're driving down the road. You want everybody to see that you are a wonderful fan, that you love your team, and it's game day. You're ready to go to the game, so what do you do before you go to the stadium? You got to stop by Bojangles and pick up your tailgate package, right? And then you pull into the stadium and you find your parking space. You get your chicken leg and you eat your chicken leg. And then you go to your seat and you find your seat. And then once you sit there, you're looking around. You're observing, right? You're a spectator. And then the game starts. What do you do then? I mean, you're up there yelling and hollering. You're hooting and howling for your team. And I mean, you're wanting to cheer them on. You're wanting them to win. And then the referee makes a bad call. I mean, what do? You start throwing the flag at him, and he's the one that's got the flag. You are upset. This is the type of scene we have here with these Pharisees. But what I want you to keep in mind, just as your power is limited when you're in the stands, I mean, you can't change the outcome of the game. As bad as you want to go down on the playing field, you can't go on the playing field. Why? Because you're nothing more than an onlooker. You are a spectator. And much was the case for the Pharisees. You see, these folks were very good at pointing fingers at other people. They were very good at hurling insults. And they were individuals that were not pursuing godliness. Although they pretended to be good, their lives displayed their evil heart. They were nothing more than puppets on a string. And they were following Satan himself. You say, that's pretty harsh, Pastor. Can you back that up? Can you prove that from Scripture? As a matter of fact, yes. And I'll show you that as we move through. But here's my challenge for you as we look at this. Don't be a spectator. Don't be a spectator when it comes to the things of God. You see, when it comes to the things of God, there's no neutral ground. You're either on one of two teams. You're either on the good team, Team Jesus, or you're either on the evil team, Team Satan. And you've got to ask yourself the question this morning, which team am I on? But notice secondly, not only do we see the spectators, I want you to notice the situation. The situation. So Jesus enters this synagogue, and there's a man standing there with a withered hand. A withered hand. So Jesus sees not only the man with the withered hand, he sees the group of Pharisees standing around as well. Now I want you to picture them as they are watching Jesus. And Jesus, although he looks at them, he puts his eyes on this man with the withered hand. And as I pointed out previously, the Pharisees' motives were impure. They were spectators. They were closely observing Jesus to see if they could trip him up, to see if they could cause him to stumble. You see, there's two observations I want to point out here, and don't miss this. The first is this. They knew that Jesus was a man full of authority. How do we know that? Because they had been with Jesus time and time again already when he had performed miracle after miracle. They had watched him firsthand perform miracles. And yet they failed to believe. They saw him bring healing. And yet they still failed to believe. And Jesus said this in John chapter 8, verse 24. He said, unless you believe that I am he, that is the Messiah, the Son of God, he says, you will die in your sins. The second thing I want you to note is this. They were eager to falsely accuse Jesus. Remember, they had already hurled accusations at him. They said, Jesus, you and your disciples, hey, you're breaking the Sabbath. You're breaking the very law of God by what you're doing. How so? Well, you're eating with sinners and tax collectors. Your disciples are working on the Sabbath. You're breaking the law. So they charge Jesus for breaking, listen to this, the very law that he created. I want you to think about that. They're wanting to charge the author with breaking the law. It's like you going to somebody who writes a book and says, hey, you didn't get this chapter right. Excuse me? You're not the author. They wrote the book, not you, and the same is true here. So they're falsely accusing Jesus, and Jesus said, do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I did not come to abolish it, but to fulfill it. So Jesus says to this man, hey, I've got something I can do for you. I can help you in this situation. So the second thing we see is that they were eager to falsely accuse Jesus. And And Jesus said, hey, that's not the case. That will not happen. So what Jesus does is then he takes his eyes off the Pharisees and he puts his eyes on this man. And listen to what he says to this man. Think about the situation. This is the good part. He looks at this man and he says, get up and come forward. Get up and come forward. Jesus intentionally seeks this man out even above the Pharisees that are hurling the accusations at him. He seeks out the destitute, the lowly, the outcast, the poor, the hurting, the helpless. Praise God Jesus does that, right? Because you and I at some point in time fell into that category. You see, the Pharisees would not have come near this man. They stayed as far away from this man with the withered hand as they could because they thought they might get a withered hand. They thought they may break the law because they hung out with this fella. And it's as though the Pharisees, as though Jesus looks at the Pharisees, he looks them in the eye and he says to them, is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath, to save a life or to kill it? Now I want you to think about that question for just a moment. Knowing the Old Testament, knowing the Ten Commandments, knowing the law of God, think about this question. Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath, to save a life or to kill? And guess what happened? You could have heard crickets in the synagogue. Not a word. Not a whisper. To be sure, they knew the right answer. I mean, they were Pharisees, right? They were rule followers. They sought to follow the Ten Commandments, although they didn't. They said the Ten Commandments, you know, this is not, hey fellas, this is not enough laws. We need more laws. So they created 600 and some odd laws to help describe the Ten Commandments. And then on top of that, they created thousands upon thousands of laws. And then you know what they did? They didn't follow the law. They went around and said, hey, are you following the law? Are you following the law? Are you following the law? Hey, are you following the law? Hey, what about you? You're breaking the law. You're working on the Sabbath. I mean, they were good at pointing fingers. And yet, they were silent. They had absolutely nothing to say. And this is not the only time that happens. There are other cases in the New Testament where Jesus' words silenced them. And then I want you to see Jesus' response here. Look at this. Jesus' response. Look at verse 5. After looking around at them with anger, grieved at their hardness of heart, he said to the man, stretch out your hand. Jesus was angry. You ever been angry before? Has Jesus ever been angry? I thought it was a sin to be angry. No, it's not a sin to be angry. And we've got to keep that in mind. But the type of anger we're referring to here is a holy, righteous anger. John MacArthur describes it this way, and I quote, as their silence filled the room, their consciences must have burned under the weight of his piercing gaze. There was no mistaking his point, nor could they have missed the righteous indignation that filled his heart and flooded his countenance. End of quote. Jesus was angry, and he had every right to be angry at what was taking place. You see, the Bible says in Ephesians 4:26, be angry, yet do not sin. So I want you to think about your anger and the type of anger that you have displayed in the past. Is it this holy, righteous anger? It's okay to be angry at the right things. It's okay to be angry at those things that contradict or violate the very word of God. Injustice, racism, abortion, child abuse. These things should cause the believer to have a holy, righteous anger. Why? Because these things violate and contradict the very word of God. The Bible says he was grieved in his heart. He was filled with sorrow. Why was this the case? He was grieved at their cold, dark, callous heart. He was grieved at their unbelief and their unwillingness to repent and believe the gospel. And all of this was fueled by their pride and their self-centeredness. So first we see the spectators. Secondly, the situation. But notice thirdly, the solution. I love this part. I like solutions. Amen. If there's a problem, I want to find a solution. And sometimes I try to get too far ahead. Sometimes I try to find a solution before even listening to the problem. Amen. So you've got to have good ears to listen and to hear the problem before developing the solution. But here we see the solution. Verse 5 says, after looking around with them in anger, grieved at their hardness of heart, he said to the man, stretch out your hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored. Amen. Praise God for that. So regardless of the day of the week, you and I should do good. I mean, we shouldn't say, well, you know, it's the Sabbath. We can't do good. That person needs help. It's the Sabbath. We can't help them on the Sabbath. No, that's what Jesus is tearing down here. Jesus is saying that it's good to help somebody Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It doesn't matter what day it is. It's good to help somebody. If somebody's animal falls in the ditch on the Sabbath, you're going to let the animal lay there and die? No, you're going to help them get the animal out. Yet, this goes back to the question that Jesus asked them, is it good to do good or to kill somebody? To do harm? Man, I'd love to have been there as this scene unfolded. This man with the withered hand, he didn't lay down on a stretcher. I mean, they didn't get any anesthesia. They didn't wheel him back to the operating room. Jesus didn't walk in and say, hey, let me have the gloves. Give me the gown. Face mask. No. What happens? According to the text, the Bible says nothing about Jesus even touching the man. What, he's got a withered hand? His hand is withered. It's all shriveled up and he needs healing. He needs restoration. He needs a solution. And Jesus doesn't even touch him. No, he doesn't have to touch him. What does he do? The man with the withered hand is standing here like this. And Jesus looks over at him. Picture this with me, if you will. He says to the man, stretch out your hand. And it's as though the man's probably thinking, my hand's withered. I can't move my hand. But instead of doing nothing, you know what he does? He begins to stretch out his hand. He begins to move his hand. And his arm goes out. And Luke tells us in his gospel that it was the man's right hand. So this withered hand disabled this man. He was not able to do the normal things that ordinary people do. Jesus said, stretch out your hand. He stretches out his hand. His fingers stretch out. He begins to wiggle his hand. Hey, he can lift his hand and praise God now, amen. Jesus restored this man. Praise God. He's now able to work. He's able to pray. He's able to do the previous things that he could not do. How is this the case? Because it was a result of the power, the grace, the mercy, the goodness, the gentleness, the compassion of our Lord and Savior. Jesus healed this man. Physically, he healed the man. But I would have you know this morning that Jesus did not just come to heal people physically. That's not the only reason that Jesus came. The Bible says that he came not to make bad people good, but to make dead people live. He came to seek and to save that which is lost. And I can't help but read this account without thinking about something that I cannot see visually with my own eyes, and that's this man's soul. Yes, he was healed physically, but what about his soul? Was his life eternally changed? And I tend to agree with Dr. Danny Akin here as to what he says concerning this account, and I quote, he says, perhaps this was also the day of the man's salvation. John 10:10 tells us that Jesus came to heal our diseases and to bear away our sins that we might have a more abundant life. Most likely, this is what happened to this man, end of quote. Perhaps you're here today or you're watching online and you say, well, Pastor, I'm good right now. I mean, I don't need any physical healing. I'm healthy. I mean, everything seems to be going good. Well, praise God. But what about deep down? What about in the recesses of your soul? You see, there's one thing certain today. Like this man, every single person that's ever walked planet Earth except Jesus Christ, needs spiritual healing. That's the greatest gift. It's a wonderful thing when God heals somebody physically, when Jesus performs a miracle and heals somebody physically, but it's even greater when they're healed spiritually. Because think about this, if they're healed physically and they're 50 years old and they live to 80, that's just 30 more years. But if they're healed spiritually, that's for all eternity. Forever and ever, they are healed spiritually. You see, like all of humanity, we need to be saved. You say, saved from what? From sin. Sin is anything you say, think, or do that's displeasing to God. And the Bible says that we've all sinned against the holy, righteous God. Our sin has separated us from God. And that's a bad deal. That's an eternally bad deal if it weren't for Jesus Christ. But do you know that Jesus did for us what we could never do for ourselves? He left the glory and the splendor of heaven. He came to earth. He was born of a virgin. He lived a perfect, sinless life. He died on an old rugged cross for your sins and mine. The Bible says on the third day, He arose from the grave victorious. He died for your sins. He died for my sins. And we've got to come face to face with the fact that the Bible says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23 says, the wages of sin is death. And I love Romans 10:9 and 10. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. Could it be today that God is speaking to you, that the Holy Spirit has placed conviction on your heart, and you need to respond to Jesus? I'll give you an opportunity to do that shortly. If you're watching online, we'll give you an opportunity to do that as well. But that'll be the greatest decision you ever make, to say yes to King Jesus. You see, Jesus is not only the solution in this story, He's the solution to every problem we have in life. It doesn't matter what your problem is. Some of you may be going through surgeries, cancer. Who knows what kind of disease or struggles you're facing? It may be mentally. Jesus is the solution to all of life's problems. And I'm so thankful that He's present today. I want you to notice, fourth and finally, their secret. Their secret. Who are you referring to, Pastor? Their secret. Well, I'm referring specifically here to the Pharisees, because in this account, we see a whole lot of Jesus. I mean, somebody once said, if you read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation and do not see Jesus, go back and reread it. Amen. Go back and reread it. So yes, we see Jesus in this text. But we also see this group of religious individuals by the name of the Pharisees. And I want you to see the secret here. I want you to see their secret. The secret plot that they devised. Look at verse 6. Verse 6 says, the Pharisees went out and immediately began conspiring with the Herodians against Him, that is Jesus, as to how they might destroy Him. Did you catch that? They had watched Jesus perform a miracle. I mean, they saw with their very eyes. They didn't need to ask somebody else. They saw it with their own eyes. They saw the man's withered hand stretch out. They saw that it was restored. And rather than bow down at the feet of Jesus and surrender, they left. They went out of the synagogue. The Bible says not only did they go out, they began conspiring with another group of individuals, the Herodians, as to how they might destroy Jesus. So because of their pride, their hard heart, they walked away in unbelief, rejecting their only hope. Instead of doing good, they chose to pursue evil. And they came face to face with Jesus, and they heard the gospel. A number of years ago, I took a trip down to Fort Caswell. It was a summer mission trip, and I was taking a group of students. And one of the assignments that we had for the week was to go out on the beach and play volleyball. I mean, that sounds like a pretty good deal, right? So we went out with a group of teenagers to play volleyball on the beach, and Our responsibility was to invite people as they walked by. Hey, you want to come over and play some volleyball with us? We're going to play a game of volleyball. And we played volleyball with them, and we tried to get to know them and build relationships with them and find out their name. And then after that, we would ask them if we could share the gospel with them. Can I tell you about Jesus? And we were using a little tool called the Evangelcube. It looks like a Rubik's Cube, but you can use that cube to walk through and explain the gospel to somebody using pictures, a great tool. So we were playing that day, and a group of young men, athletic young men from UNC came up. I didn't hold that against them. But we played volleyball with them, and then afterwards there was a tall gentleman, and I looked at him and I said, hey, what's your name? He said, my name's Christian. I said, hey, Christian, can I talk to you for just a few minutes? He said, yeah, sure. So I looked at Christian. I mean, he was a big young man, active man. He was a built, handsome young man. And I began to talk with Christian and share the gospel with him. And as I was doing so, I asked Christian, I said, hey, you know, would you like to put your trust and your faith in Jesus? And this was his response. He said, I trust in my family. I trust in my friends that I have right here. I trust in the things that are tangible. I trust in the things that I can see and I can touch. So you don't want to put your trust and faith in Jesus? Nah. You see, there's a lot of people in the world today like Christian. And some will even go as far to say, if I could only see Jesus perform a miracle, if I could see him do it, then I would believe. No, you wouldn't. I mean, these guys didn't. They saw the miracle firsthand and they said, we want no part of what Jesus has to offer. So Christian, that day, chose to walk away from the gospel, and so did the Pharisees. Don't walk away from Jesus. I don't care how bad it gets. I mean, we tend to think as Christians, we trust Jesus, and from that point forward, everything's going to be a bed of roses. Sunshine and the beach, amen? But Jesus didn't promise us that. He never promised us that. You know, we read these passages and we tend to look over those verses that say, endure, endure, count it pure joy, my brethren, when you face various trials. So don't walk away from Jesus. The Pharisees did that. And then they found a group of folks by the name of the Herodians. They were these ungodly followers of Herod the Great. And they said, hey guys, let's come up with a plan. Let's come up with a plan to destroy this guy. To destroy Jesus. I mean, to do away with him. I mean, if we could just keep him quiet and keep him out of the synagogue. A lot of people think that about Christians today. Man, if those Christians would just hush. You know what Christians need to do? Stand up! Stand up for Jesus, amen? Yet the minority has the loudest voice. Because believers, for the most part, sit down. We got to stand up. They said, we got a plan. We're going to kill him. They desired evil instead of good. They had rather kill than to save a life. And there's a lot of folks walking that same road today. You know, the Bible says that the road is wide. And there are many walking that road that leads to destruction. But narrow is the gate, and few find it. You see, they were walking this road, this wide road, that led to destruction not only in that life, but ultimately caused them to end up in a place called hell. And that's not what God desires for anybody. You see, the Bible says it's not His desire that any should perish, but that all come to repentance. Let me ask you this morning as we close. What about you? What about you? Do you desire good, or do you desire evil? Have you surrendered your life to Jesus? Are you passionately pursuing Him, or is there evil in your heart? I plead with you this morning to choose this day whom you will serve. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Choose Jesus. Choose life. I'm going to ask, if you will, to stand for just a moment, heads bowed and eyes closed, as we think and meditate about what we've heard this morning, as to how God may have spoken to our heart. Maybe you're listening this morning and you're here and you say, Pastor, there's never been a time when I've surrendered my life to Jesus. And God spoke into my heart this morning and I know I need to say yes to Jesus. I'm going to ask you to do that right now. You can acknowledge that in the form of a prayer. We call the prayer the sinner's prayer, but there's nothing magical about the prayer. It's no magical formula. It's just you believing and trusting that Jesus is Lord. Right now, if you're watching online and listening, or if you're here and you need Jesus, just pray this prayer. Heavenly Father, today I admit that I'm a sinner, and I know my sin separates me from you. But I've heard the gospel, and today I'm turning from my sin and I'm trusting Jesus with my life. I believe that He lived the perfect life. He died on the cross for my sins, and today I'm saying yes to Jesus. Help me from this day forward not to live for myself, but to passionately pursue Jesus. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for saving me, for giving me life. In Jesus' name I pray. Hey, if you prayed that prayer, I would love to talk with you afterwards. I would love to communicate with you if you're watching online. You can shoot me an email, or you can comment in the message section there. Maybe you're watching this morning, you're listening here this morning, and you say, you know, Pastor, I don't fall into the category of the Pharisees, but if I'm honest, there's been evil in my heart at times. I've judged people with impure motives. And there are areas and aspects of the story of the Pharisees that we looked at last Sunday and even today that I can relate to. And I need to confess that before you for what it is. I need to confess that as being evil. Hey, right now as I pray, you pray and ask God to forgive you. You can apply 1 John 1:9. I love that verse. If you confess your sins, He's faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Pray with me this morning. Father, we love you. God, we thank you for the gift of life. God, we thank you for the word that we've heard this morning. Lord, it's our prayer that we would follow the example of Jesus, that we would seek to do good regardless of what day it is, regardless of who it is, regardless of where it is, that we would seek to do good, and by doing so, we will be loving you with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and we'll be loving our neighbor as ourselves. Father, help us to do that. Help us to be a church and individuals that make up this body of believers that are known for those two things, loving God and loving other people. God, I pray you would help us, that you would be with us today and in the days to come. God, may Jesus be glorified in all that we say, in all that we think, and all that we do. For we pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus. In His name I pray. Amen.